previous class, we were discussing about Indian National Movement. What are the phases of Indian National Movement? Already we have discussed in the detail how the moderate phase, the extremist leaders, they have contributed their contribution in order to get the freedom for our country, India, and in order to get the freedom for our country, India. And apart from that, the Gandhian phase, which was the last phase of Indian National Movement, which has given a lot of benefits, and apart from that, it has given an opportunity for our country, India, to get the freedom from the Britishers, and in order to throw out the Britishers from our country, India. Today, we are going to discuss about the Government of Indian Acts. As in the previous year, in the 1909, 1919, 1935, 1947, in the respective years, many of the governmental acts were passed. And these acts were passed by the colonial British government in order to have the rule over our country, India. And these acts were passed to regulate the administration and protect the interests of the common people. For that purpose only, the Government of India Acts were introduced in our country, India. The first act which was introduced was the Indian Council Act in the year 1909. The second act which was introduced in the year 1919, which was known as Government of India Act. The Government of Indian Act in the year 1935. Government of Independence Act in the 1947. In this respective period of time, the colonial British government, they have been passed the many acts for the Government of India, for the governance of India, and apart from that, in order to regulate so that they administrate you and protect the common interest on the hands, and in order to have the moral elements should be included into our country, India. For that purpose only, the Government of Indian Act were passed in this respective period of time. Today we are going to discuss about the Government of Indian Acts in respective period of time. What were the provisions? What was the cause for this act to be introduced? Who has been introduced this act? We are going to discuss in the detail today. That means the Government of Indian Acts, where many of the acts were passed during the period of time in the 1773, as the acts was passed for the regulating the act, and Charter Act also was passed between the year 1833 and 1853. Respective period of time, many acts were passed, but these four acts were popularized, which you can see on. First is the Indian Council Act in the year 1909. The Government of Indian Act in the year 1919, Government of Indian Act in the year 1935, Government, that is the Independence Act in the 1947, which is the last and the final act which was passed by the British government. In one by one, we are going to discuss it. Coming to the first act, which was introduced in the year 1909, that was the Indian Council Act. Indian Council Act, it is also known as Minto Morley Reform Act. Why? Because this act was formulated with the initiative of Lord Minto, who was the Viceroy and the Governor General of India, and the Lord John Morley, who was the Secretary of State of our country, India, during the period of time. For that purpose, this act was known as Minto Morley Reform Act. That means Indian Council Act is also known as Minto Morley Reform Act. Why? Because it was initiated, it was started by the Minto Morley, who was the Viceroy and the Governor General of our country, India. For that purpose, Indian Council Act also was known as the Minto Morley Reform Act. According to this act, the membership of the central and the provincial legislature council was enlarged. That means in order to provide the membership, that Indians membership, into the central government and the provincial legislature. Provincial legislature, that is a state government, and how they have to get the enlarged the powers into the provincial legislature. For that purpose only, the Minto Morley Reform Act was introduced in the year 1909. However, the members of elected members of these councils, also less than half of the total membership, were given recognition in this act. And this Act, it was introduced by in order to have the discontentment which was among the people against the British government, in order to articulate the demands and whatever the moderate for the representation of Indian Council demanding for the Muslim communities for the political accommodation. That means they have to get the political accommodation and the political recognition should be given for the Muslim community and the spread of Indian national movement. With this entering only, the extremist phase has came into the existence. With this initiative only, the Indian Council Act was introduced in the year 1909. That means 1909 Act is also known as Minto Morley Reform Act. Why we are saying it as a Minto Morley Reform Act? Because this act was initiated and formulated by the Lord Minto and Lord John Morley, who was the Viceroy and the Governor General of country India. For that purpose, this act is also known as Indian Council Act in the year 1909. Understood, student? That means Indian Council Act is also known as Minto Morley Reform Act. Why this act was initiated? It was initiated in order to have whatever the discontent, that is a growing discontent which was going among the Indian people against the British government, in order to demand whatever the demands were there. Demands were there from the moderate, for the representation of Indian Council, demanding that the Muslim communities also, that for the political accommodation should be given, and the spread of Indian national movement with the entering of the moderate, that is the extremist faith. With this initiative only, the Indian Council Act was introduced in the year 1909. Next, we are going to discuss about the provision of this act. That means provisions are nothing but what initiative was taken into consideration by Minto Morley in order to introduce and in order to have the British, that means whatever the discontent among the people was growing into the Indian society, in order to remove that only, this initiative was done by the Indian Council Act to give the recognition for the Indians into the political activities. The main provision of Indian Council Act, the first, it is that numerical strength, that means the numerical strength, the number wise they have to give the increase into the central legislature, that is the central government. That means they have been increased the numerical strength in the legislative, that is the central legislative council, from 16 to 60, and they also decided that the provincial legislature, that is a less, that is a state legislature, this council should consist of minimum, at least a minimum from 30 to 50 they have to increase. This was the first provision of Indian Council Act, which was introduced during the period of 1909. The first was what? The provision was that the first provision was that the numerical strength has to be increased. The numerical strength has been increased also. In the central legislature, they have increased from 16 to 60, whereas the provincial legislature council, from the maximum, they have increased to 30 to maximum, it was 50. That was the first provision. The next, second provision, that the separate electorates were introduced in India. That means they have to provide the separate electorate should be given. Separate electorate, like general election should be there, that is a general electorate should be there. Class electorate they have to have, and they have to cover the landlords, Muslims, and the social electorates also should be covered. The chamber of commerce were also created. That means they have to provide the separate electorate should be introduced in our country, India. That was the second provision of Indian Council Act, to have the separate electorate system should be introduced in our country, India. The third, it was that introduced indirect election system, with the right to vote were restricted to the very few peoples. What is the right indirect election? That means indirect elections where the right to vote will be given in the hands of the few peoples. That means all the people will not participate into the election. That is known as indirect election. This system was introduced with the right to vote, which was given only, were restricted only for the few peoples, not for the all. Everybody is not having the right to have the right to vote into this election. That was the third provision of Indian Council Act. That was the act has introduced indirect election system with the right to vote were restricted to the very few people. That means this act has introduced indirect election, where the people have to participate, a few peoples only will participate into the election procedure. The last is that this act facilitated one Indian to be nominated to the Governor General Executive Council. That means the one Indian people will be nominated as a Governor General Executive Council. And the two Indians also will be nominated as a Council of Secretary for the state for the Indian affairs. That means they are providing the concession to the Indian society to have the part into the political activities. These were the provisions, the main provisions of Indian Council Act. The first was that numerical strength has to be increased, and the numerical strength has also been increased by increasing from 16 to 60, and whereas the provincial legislature council also it has been increased from 30 to 52. And apart from that, they have provided a separate electorate. We are also introduced in our country India, and this act also introduced indirect election system where the right to vote were restricted to the very few people. That means the very few people only will have the right to vote. Like universities are there, district boards are there, municipalities are there, chamber of commerce and landlords were there. They were elected by its their own members only. That means indirect elections were introduced during the period of this time only, 1909. And this act also facilitated that the Indian should be nominated, at least one Indian has to be nominated as a Governor General, and apart from that, two Indians also should get the seat as a Council of Secretary of the state for the Indian affairs. These were the main provisions of Indian Council Act. Indian Council Act is also known as Minto Mowglai Reform Act. Why? Because it was initiated and formulated by the Minto and Mowglai, who was the Viceroy and the Governor General of India. And this was initiative in order whatever the growing discontent among the people was going against the British government, and the demands of the moderate also the representation should be given to the Indians into the council. That means the Indians has to get the recognition into the council. For that purpose only this act was initiated in the year 1909. These are the main provisions of Indian Council Act, which has been introduced in our country India during the period of 1909. That means the first is the numerical strength has to be increased in the central legislature also and the provincial legislature also. That means from the 16 to 60, 30 to 52. And the separate electorates also were introduced. And apart from that, they have introduced the indirect elections where the vote, the right to vote will be restricted only for the few people. That means only the people only they have internally, they'll have the elections and they'll participate into the election. That means all the people will not have the right to vote and right to vote and to participate into the election. This act also facilitate that one Indian should be nominated. That means Indian should be nominated to the governor as a Governor General, Executive Council, and the two Indians should be nominated as a Council of Secretary of the state for the Indian affairs. Indian affairs, in order to look out all the affairs and the needs and the satisfying the needs of the people, in order to that the Indians affairs also should be nominated. Two members have to be nominated. This is the first Indian Act which was introduced in our country India in the 1909. That means we have discussed about how this Indian Council Act has initiated, has how it has been came into the existence, what was the main motto in order to introduce this act in our country India, what are the main provisions also we have discussed. That means Indian Council Act, which has been organized, which was passed in the year 1909, in order to have the representation, that means Indians should get the representation into the council. And they also demanded that the Muslim community, they have to get the accommodation also. Recognition should be given to the Muslim community. With this initiative only, this Indian Council Act was passed in our country India in the 1909. Coming to the second act, which is known as Government of India Act in the 1919. And when we are talking about this act, during this period of time, extremist phase and the methods and the ideas, whatever it was organized by the extremist leaders, they were widely favored by the people. And the members also, they were factoring that the contribution and whatever the political situation in India is there, or expressive rules, which was policies were formulated by the British government. For example, like we have discussed in the extremist phase about Lord Curzon, who has initiated the law passed by him. He has said that the division of Bengal should be given into two provincial, and these people, Indian people, they were not supporting to the division of Bengal. During that period of time, many acts, many incidents were occurred, and this act also represented the end of the beloved despotism. That is, a despotism is nothing but the act of authorities enhancing themselves only. That means whatever it is provided to them. for the Britishers. It was utilized by the Britishers rather than the Indian community. And they also genius of the responsible government has to be set up. And this has came into the existence by the review which was made by Simon Commission in the 10 years. And this act also, it has provided that the king empire issues whatever the proclamations has been given by the parliamentary legislature for the India. And the intent of the act, that is the Government of Indian Act in the year 1919, it has came into the existence on 23rd December 1919. That means in order to repressive measures, and apart from that, whatever the repressive policies were introduced by the Britishers, in order to this act has to be implemented in our country, India, against that only, in order to get the participation of Indians into the government of India, this act was passed in the year 1919. The main provision of the Government of India Act, the first was that the central government should become the bicameralism. Bicameralism means it should consist of, bicameralism is nothing but the central legislature should become the bicameralism with the Council of States with the 16 members. That means they should have, the Council of States should be there. The central legislature should become the bicameral. Bicameral is nothing but parliament should consist of only one house, that is a bicameralism. And apart from that, they have demanded that the Council of State with the members of, that is the 60 members, and the Legislative Assembly with the 164 members. This was the first provision of the Government of Indian Act in the year 1919. That was the central legislature should become bicameral, and they have to provide the council, that means they have to have the power extended to them, the Council of States with then 60 members, and the Legislative Assembly with 146 members has to be increased. That means legislature, that is the central legislature, has to become bicameral, that is the one house, consisting of one house. The second main provision of Government of Indian Act in the 1919, that was the diarchy system was introduced. Diarchy system means what? The diarchy system is nothing but implementing of power between the two. Between the two means they should have the two level up, that is a provincial level and at the state level, that is a central level, the provincial level and the central level. And apart from that, this system also introduced that the subject matter which has to be introduced into the provincial level, they should be divided into two groups. There was the two groups. The first group was reserve subjects, and the second, it was a transfer subject. Reserve subjects means the subjects which has to be revised only by the, at the provincial level, at the central level, that were finance, like irrigation, law and order, which any changes has to be done in the finance, irrigation and the law and orders which has to be passed. These subjects are included into the reserve subject. Coming to the transfer subject, transfer subject means it can be transferred between the state, that is the central legislature, to the provincial legislature. This can be transferred, and they were the directly controlled by the governors only. They should not have, these subjects will not be given to the any other authorities. These subjects are known as transfer subject. This system was, this was the second provision of Indian Governmental Act in the year 1919. That means they have introduced diarchy system, and this diarchy system was introduced at the provincial level. Under this system, what they have said, the subject matter, whatever the administration subject matter has to be introduced, it should be divided into two groups. That was, first was reserve subject and the transfer subject. Coming to the reserve subject, it will be reserved only at the provincial level. That means it will be controlled by the state government, and this authority can be given only for the state government, that is the finance, irrigation, law and order, etc. These subject matters will come into the reserve subject. Coming to the transfer subject, these are the very important subjects will be there, and this transfer subject cannot be given to the other authority. For that purpose, it will be directly controlled by the governor. The next, it is the provincial legislature, that is the legislative council, where to be unicameral. That means the unicameral is a single. That means the legislative council should consist of unicameral. And this unicameral means they should consist, legislative council should consist of one house. This was introduced by the by the Indian Government Act in the 1919. The next, it was the Sikh, Anglo-Indians, Christians and the Europeans also were granted separate electoral system has to be given to this community people also. And apart from that, this system also introduced indirect election came to be replaced with the direct election. That means indirect elections was introduced in year 1909 according to the Indian Council Act. They has introduced indirect election. Indirect election has to be replaced and the direct election has to come into the existence. This was the proclamation, this was the provisions of Indian Governmental Act in the year 1919. And this act also provided that to the establish the statutory commission. In order to statutory commissions are nothing but these commissions will have the authority to get into the matter, that means inquiry into the working and the progress of this act and the periodical manner, that means in the period to period what it is happening, all this collection of data will be done only by the statutory commission. That means this Indian Governmental Act in the 1919, the main provision of this was to establish statutory commission. That means this statutory commission has to do the inquiry into the working and the progress of this act. Periodically they have to see whether the progress is going on or not, what it is happening into the act, whether they are following all the provisions, the main provisions which is provided and which has been initiated by the Indian Governmental Act in the 1919. Everything this has to be satisfied by the statutory commission. These are the main provisions of Government of Indian Act in the year 1919. What this act has initiated, the first they have been demanded that the first provision was the central legislation should become the bicameral. That means they should have the consisting of two houses where the Council of States with 60 members and the Legislative Assembly with 160 members. And apart from that, they have demanded for the diarchy system should be introduced at the provincial level. Under this system, they have been demanded that the two subject matter, that is the reserve subject and the transfer subject. The reserve subjects like finance is there, irrigation, law and order, like this it will be coming. Whereas the transfer subject, it will be directly controlled by the governor. And this provision also provided that the provincial levels, that is the legislative council, should become the unicameral. Sikh, Anglo-Indians, Christians and the European also should be granted as a separate electoral system has to be given. Whatever the indirect elections were held, it has to be replaced with the direct elections. These are the main provisions of Indian Governmental Act in the year 1919, which has been passed during the period of 1919. Next, coming to the Government of Indian Act in the year 1935. When we are talking about during this period of time, the statutory commission was set up, as we have discussed in the period of Gandhian phase. Statutory commission was set up by the known as Sir John. That was a Simon commission which was set up, and the Gandhiji along with the Gandhiji, many of the prominent leaders, they have been not been the part of this commission, and they have given the slogan of Simon, you go back. Why? Because they doesn't want this commission has to be introduced in our country India. And the Indians also, they have been increasing the demands for the greater role of the government. And apart from that, they doesn't want any concession which has to be granted by the Britishers. During that time, the First World War and during the period of Second World War also, the Britishers, they have given an opportunity for the Indians to be the part of the First and Second World War. Then they grant the freedom to our country India. And during this introducing of this system, which is known as the provincial, that is a diarchy system, that is the certain areas, the government such as education were replaced and the ministries were responsible. There was the provincial legislature was there, that means the public orders, law and orders and the finance, where the subject matters were divided between the two authorities, that is the reserve subjects and the transfer subjects were there. Understood, in the previous act we have discussed about that. With this initiative only, the experiments which was done by the British government, that was introducing of diarchy, which has proved that unsatisfactory to the Indian society. And not only to the Indian society, they need the nominal control and the pursues, the strings were still in the hands of the British officialdom. And that means they have their authority into our country India. During this period of time, the Indian government, that means Indians, they needs that the India's recognition should be given rather than the any concession which was granted by the two acts, that is was in the 1909 and 1990. In the 1935, they have said that the Indian Commission, that means this act has to provide the full recognition to the Indians rather than the any concession. This for that purpose only, this Government of Indian Act was passed in the year 1935. The main provision of this act was, the first one is that this act provided for the creation of all India Federation based on the union of provisions of the British India, ruled India and the princely state. The new prince, the provinces, that is Odisha and the Sindh, should be created. This act has provided that the creation of all India Federation has to be done. All India Federation by providing the union of provision. Union of provision means they should have the central government and the British rule in India, and whatever the princely states were there, they have to provide the new provisions. For example, like Orissa and the Sindh has to be created. That means Sindh and the Orissa should be created as a new state. That was the first provision of Government of Indian Act in the 1935. The second, it was that this act also provided that establishment of diarchy system. Diarchy system at the central government, wherever the reserve subjects, what are the reserve subjects are there, finance is there, law and orders are there. And apart from that, external affairs, all were to be administered. The Governor General and has to be confident, and the transfer subject were to be administrated by the Indians, and the latter were responsible to the legislature. That means, as we know, the legislature, it makes the laws. Understand, the laws has to be made by the legislature, and this responsibility should be given to the legislature. This was the second provision of Government of Indian Act in the 1935. The third provision is that the introduction of provincial autonomy. That means whatever the provincials are there, states are there, they should get the autonomy, and with the complete responsible government should be given. Responsible government means where whatever the authority should be implemented by the government, it should be implemented by its government only. That means the provincials with the elected ministries made answerable to the legislature. That means whatever if any conflict arises into the government, these ministers, elected ministers, they should be answerable to the legislature. It abolished the diarchy into the provincial. That means the diarchy system, it should not be introduced into the provincial level. At the central level, they should not have the two level of government. This was a third provision of Government of Indian Act in the 1935. The next, it was that increasing strength and the power of the elected members, which has to be enlarged both in the central and the provincial level. That means they have the numerical strength should be increased into the central level and in the state level. As in the previous class already we discussed about the governmental three organs of the government. What are the three organs? Legislature, executive and the judiciary is there. Legislature, it makes the laws. That means the law, it is known as lawmaking body. This has to be given only for the legislature. Whereas the executive, it is the most important. Why? Because implementation of the laws will be in the hands of the legislature. This strength and the power should be given to the central and the provincial legislature. Governor, next it is the governor were given the special power and they could vote the legislative action and the legislature. They own authorities. That means the governor should be given much authority and the special power should be given to the governor. The next, it is the division of administrative items between the union and the state. That means what they will be having, the government will have consisting of three lists. That is a union list, state list and the concurrence list. And this list will be equally has to be distributed between the union and the state, where the federal court should be given to them. Federal court, where their authority will be having the two types of court, at the center and at the state level. That is, at the state level we are having the high court, and the central level we are having the Supreme Court. The next, it is a separate representation for the Indian, that is the Christians, Anglo-Indians, Europeans and the Cypriot class in the Legislative Council. The special reservation quota should be given. The separate reservation quota should be given to the Christians, Anglo-Indians and the Europeans and the Cypriot class of our society. These are the main provisions which has been taken initiated in the year 1935, which is known as the Government of Indian Act in the 1935. In the 1935, the needs a complete freedom should be given. That means the needs the Purna Pact was signed. Purna Pact is nothing but a Purna Swaraj should be given. Apart from that, recognition giving only for the few members involving into the political activity, they doesn't want any concession. They needs the full authority. That means Indians should be governed by the Indian authority rather than the British. With this initiative only, the Government of Indian Act was passed in the year 1935. This was the main provision of the Government of Indian Act. They are, according to the examination point of view, this answer will come for the 5 marks. It's compulsory question you to write about the Government of Indian Act in the 1935. In that sense, you have to write how this Government of Indian Act has initiated, it has been started in order to have the greater demand and the greater role of the government of the country. That means in the since 19th centuries, as we have seen that the Britishers only were ruling our country. For that purpose, the Indians needs the recognition into the governmental activities. With this initiative only, the Government of India Act was announced in the year 1935. The last act which was passed in the year 1947, that was the Indian Independence Act in the 1947. That means India got freedom. Where? And this was the last and the final act which was formulated and implemented by the British government. And this has been drafted. Whatever the authorities were taken the consideration by the domains and the parliament of United Kingdom, that the partition of British India into the two independent domains has to be made, that is India and the Pakistan. And the same, they have been demanded that the independence will be given to the India and the Pakistan, and thus they have been. The act received the royal assent on 18th July 1947, and the thus India and the Pakistan comprising the West, that is a modern day Pakistan, and the East, that is a modern day Bangladesh, the regions came into, began on 15th August, and the legislature representatives, they have been said that the Muslim League and the Sikh communities came into an agreement with Lord Mountbatten on what has come to be known as a 3 June, on the 3rd June plan or the Mountbatten plan. And this plan was the last plan for the independence. This act has been initiated in our country India in the 1947, which was granted, and this act was the final act which was introduced in our country India in the 1947. Next coming to the provisions of this act. The first provision was the division of British India into two domains. What the domains? They have been decided that the India and the Pakistan on the same day, they have to provide the independence to them. With this effect only, the 15th August 1947, where the British India has granted the independence to the India and the Pakistan. The partition of the provincial of Bengal and the Punjab between the two new countries has been came into the existence. And apart from that, the establishment of the office also, that is the Governor General, for the each two states has to be created. That means they should get the representatives. The separate representatives should be given to the India and the Pakistan. And the lastly, they have said that the territories of the two domains were defined, but they were empowered to include or exclude their territories themselves only. They have been said that the two territories of the two domains, that is India and the Pakistan, where whatever it is there, they are empowered. Whichever the territory they want to include or whichever the territory they want to exclude also, these authorities will be given to the two domains, that is the India and the Pakistan. These are the main provisions of Indian Independence Act in the year 1947. That means this act is the last and the final act which was passed by the British government in our country India in order to grant the independence to our country India in the 1947. They have granted the independence to both the countries. That was the two, one more country has been formed, that was Pakistan, and they have been given the independence to these two domains. In this class, we have discussed about the four. In this class, we have discussed about the Government of Indian Act in the 19 1935, 1947, the Indian Council Act we have discussed. Indian Council Act is also known as Minto-Morley Reform Act. How it was initiated in the year 1909 in order to provide the authority for the Indian authority to be introduced into the council. And apart from that, we have discussed about the Government of Indian Act in the 1919, where the India should get the authorities and Indians, the few part of the Indians should get the authorities into the administrative structure. And apart from that, we have discussed about the Government of Indian Act in the 1935, where the statutory commissions were set up, and whatever the discontent was growing into the year 1935, there doesn't want any concession by the Britishers. The needs, the full authority should be given to the Indians rather than the Britishers. The last act, which was the Indian Independence Act in the 1947, which was initiated by the British government, and this act is also known as the last and the final act which was introduced by the British government in order to have to grant the freedom to our country India, and the new country also was formed, that was Pakistan. Today we'll stop here, girls. In the next class, we are going to discuss about the Constituent Assembly and the salient features of Indian Constitution. Before knowing that, historical backgrounds, how the freedom fighters and the leaders, they have initiated, what plans were taken into consideration, how the preamble was made in our country, India, and we are going to learn about the philosophy and the basic features of Indian Constitution. Then later on, we are going to discuss about the silent features of Indian Constitution. If you are having any doubt, note down all the points into a notebook, so that whatever we have recalled into the classes, it is from the examination point of view, this chapter is very important. 2 marks, 10 marks, and the 5 marks questions mostly comes from this chapter. Thank you, students.